slide in today?
Yes.
Yes. You're here, though. You know? We're not used to the snow, are we? We've got too much weather. I prefer the good weather over this.
Ryan.
All right, have a seat. Let's see, if there's a seat next to you, raise your hand.
Is that?
Yeah, this is right.
We've got plenty of seats. Come and find a seat.
There's one right here, yeah.
There's two over here.
Harold.
Tiffany, come right up here to the front. You and your brother. Sit right up here. I want to be able to see your eyeballs. All right, Amy, there's a seat up here. You want to come and get a seat? Tony? All right. We got some special music going on this morning, so here we go. Heidi?
Good morning. Okay, I guess I will just say a little something. In light of the recent tragedies that we have experienced here, we prepared a couple special songs this morning. But this first one, I did not pick. Caleb did not pick it. I was driving to school on Wednesday, and I was kind of conversating in my head with Roland, and I said, look, we're going to perform you a song at Jumpstart on Sunday, and I said, I want you to pick a song, and it's going to be whatever song comes up on my Spotify that I was randomizing all this music through. This was the next song that came up, and I just had no doubt that it was from him, so thank you.
And after the storm, I run and run as the rains come, and I look up. I look up on my knees and out of luck. I look up. Night has always pushed out day. Must know life to see decay, but I won't rot. I won't rot. Not this mind and not this heart. I won't rot. So I took you by the hand, and we stood tall, remembering our own land. What we live for, and then will come a time you'll see, with no more tears, where love will not break your heart, but dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see what you find there, with grace in your heart and flowers in your hair. So now I cling to what I knew. I saw exactly what was true. That's why I hold. That's why I hold. With all I have, that's why I hold. And I won't die alone and be left there. So I guess I'll just go home. Oh, God knows where. Because death is just too soon. And man's so small. Well, I'm scared of what's behind. And once before. And there will come a time you'll see, with no more tears, where love will not break your heart, but dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see what you find there, with grace in your heart and flowers in your hair. Yes, there will come a time you'll see, with no more tears, where love will not break your heart, but dismiss your fears, get over your hill and see what you find there, with grace in your heart and flowers in your hair. Angels lead you in.
Cruiser, there's a guest singer.
Guest singer? Oh, okay.
She's not here yet.
Oh, okay.
She has not yet arrived.
All right. That's okay. We're flexible. All right, Audra, this is for you back there. I'm not sure it's the version that you wanted, but it's what you're going to get, okay?
One thing I do know is that I came tonight because I need you. And you need me. Because we're all a part of God's army. And how many know this tonight? I believe this, that it is the will of God that every need that you have, it be supplied. Oh, how many of y'all feel that? Turn around and touch three people around you. Don't be scared, because they may be looking like they don't want to have church, but they plan. Tell them, I need you. I need you. You need me. Don't be acting funny. Somebody just lift your hands up. Just lift your hands up. Wow. My hands up. Jesus.
Thank you.
Audra. That's a cool song, isn't it? We need you to survive. Now, I think that our guest has arrived, so I need to check. So if so, we're going to have one more song. Is that correct, Dick? They have arrived? Oh, I thought, here's Ryan. And here's Ryan.
All right, Ryan, yay!
All right.
Ryan.
Let's see if they are ready to do their song. We will get them going.
You might just mention that the tithing box is open back here.
Oh, there's Dick. Dick is always thinking about money. Isn't that awesome? There's a tithing box open.
Who else needs a member?
Yeah, who else? Get up one, Dick.
I have 50 more of them. 60 more.
Remember, Malachi. Remember, Malachi says, you know, give God the tithe. And what does he do? He's going to open up the windows of heaven, and he's going to pour you out a blessing that you cannot contain.
That's right.
It's a godly principle. We give, and then we receive. God's kingdom is backwards than what we really think it should be, you know. We want to have what we see right now. But God's kingdom says that you have faith first, and believe first, and then you receive. And that's the way it is. Are they coming?
Almost.
We're almost there. All right. So anything else, Dick, that you can think of that we can talk about while we're waiting?
So, Mary.
Yes.
I have something I want to add to that.
Okay.
I was reading in this book last night, and it was talking about forgiving versus forgetting. And it was the first time I'd ever seen those words like that, where you take the word forget, and it's forgetting,
okay,
which causes us to forget why we're here.
Right.
And forgiving, so giving causes us to remember why we're here. So I just wanted to throw that in there. I thought that was pretty cool. That's what I got.
Okay. Okay, so here we have Jeremy and David and this young lady. I don't even know her name. Kaylee. All right. So, I guess you have a microphone there. Okay.
Laser. Should I plug in some here? Thank you.
kinds of awesome talent, right?
Yeah.
Is John Bradley here? Raise your hand. Hi, John. Happy birthday coming up. Right? When is it? Wednesday? Happy birthday. All right, so there's a scripture in the Bible where God is being very passionate to his people. And God is such a loving God that he cried out and he said, "My people perish for a lack of knowledge." And we need to take hold of that and we need to understand what he's talking about. His people, our people, the people today are perishing for a lack of knowledge. God is love, and he wants so much that none of us, not one person, would be lost and left behind. He's given us every single thing that we need to accomplish what he has put in our life, the desires that he has. He wants to fulfill the destiny that he has for each one of us. When people continually walk off course, they continually stray out of the scope of walking a godly, holy life. They are going to walk out of the presence of God. And his presence is beautiful. And when we continue to rebel against him, when we continue to walk off course, we walk away from his covering, from his presence. It's no different than what Judas did. Judas was a very smart man. He was a leader among the people at that time. He had an aptitude for math, and that's why Jesus made him his treasurer. People say that Jesus was poor. Well, let me ask you a question. If Jesus was poor, why did he need a personal treasurer to take care of his money? If he was poor, he wouldn't have needed that. So he appointed Judas, and Judas became Jesus's personal treasurer. And then what happened is Judas walked off a course, didn't he? The Bible tells us that he went with the wrong crowd. He went with the thugs of that day instead of staying with Jesus. Now, he had watched Jesus. He had seen Jesus's miracles. He had heard Jesus's sermons over and over again. He knew who Jesus was, and yet he made a choice. He chose to go hang out with the thugs. And when he walked away from the presence of God, he couldn't handle the guilt of that anymore. He couldn't handle the shame of that anymore. And Judas ended up taking his own life because of guilt and shame. He didn't have to. Jesus gave him an opportunity to come back to the fold, and Judas did not do that. The Bible says that he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God will remain stable and fixed under the shadow of the Almighty. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your left, but it will not come nigh you. And we need to understand that we need to remain. We need to stay. We need to be in the presence of the Most High God. And we need to get educated and know what that means to stay and remain in his loving presence, because in his presence we are covered. In his presence no foe can get us. In his presence Satan cannot knock us off of the course. We need to stay eyes fixed straight ahead. Our prayers are the most powerful thing that we can have. In James 5:16, it says, "Confess. Confess your faults one to another that you may be healed." Now listen, we want healing. We don't want to take on the disease and sicknesses of this world. We don't want to take on the disease and sicknesses of drugs and alcohol. We do not want to take on disease and sicknesses in our body. So what do we do? Well, this says, "Confess your faults one to another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous man availeth much." We don't think our prayers do any good. They do. If you have fervent, effectual prayers, they will availeth much. Listen, do not perish. Do not perish just because you don't understand every word that is in the Bible. Do not perish just because you don't understand. Keep at it. Keep going. And God, the Holy Spirit, will give you the understanding that comes with the promises in His Word. Do not perish because you refuse to take God's Word and apply it to your life. We can't just hear the Word. We have to take the Word and we have to apply it to our lives. Too many times people are just mimicking their recovery. Our minds have become so abused with mind-altering substances that we need to make every effort. We need to do everything in our power to wake up our brains. And that is the reality of what many of us are facing. We lack knowledge in the structure and order that God even created. Last week we talked about our brain and how important it is to heal our brain. We talked about renewing our mind with the Word of God. And we need to take these things and apply them to our lives so that we can make a change, so that we do not perish. We do not want to perish. We have to stop mimicking recovery and we have to start doing recovery. We lack knowledge in the structure and that God created. There's an order to everything that He created. When we know what the proper order is, it's half of the battle. God is first in our life. That's the way it should be. He should always be number one. He is always first in our life. And do you know that's where Satan got into trouble? Because he rose up against God because he wanted to be God. He wanted to sit on the throne of God. Satan was the top dog in heaven. Satan was the top angel in heaven. And he got full of himself, full of pride. And when he did this, God kicked him out. Listen, if God can kick out an angel, we better watch it. Ezekiel 28:12 says this. He's talking about Satan. He said, "You were the signet of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the sardius, topaz, diamond, onyx, jasper, emerald, and carbuncle. And crafted in gold were your settings and your engravings. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. You were an anointed guardian cherub. A cherub is an angel. I placed you. You were on the holy mountain of God, in the midst of the stones of fire, and walked. You were blameless in all of your ways from the day that you were created, till unrighteousness was found in you. In the abundance of your trade, you were filled with violence in your midst, and you sinned. So I cast you as a profane thing from the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O guardian cherub." And then it goes on from there. The reason I bring this up and why I read this scripture to you is that Satan had it all. I mean, he was adorned with the most precious jewels that God had ever created. He had everything. And then what he did is he let pride enter into his heart. And when he did that and he thought that he was better than God, God kicked him out. I ask, why are the consequences of our actions not enough? Why are the consequences of our actions not enough to change our life? Why do we hear a word from God that is so important and that can change our lives, and yet we can want to still go around the same dumb old mountain time and time and time again? Why is that? I had a conversation this week with a young lady in my office, and I asked that same question. Why are our consequences to our actions not enough to change our lives once and for all? Why do we continue to walk back to the dog's vomit? We know it wasn't good the first go around, and yet we go back there time and time and time again. Why was the consequences of the actions that Satan had in his heart not enough? Why did he not change his way? God would have given him a chance to change his ways, but he was so full of himself that he would not do what he knew that he should do. You know, we hear, and I've even talked many, many times, I have said it passionately from the bottom of my heart. I have said, your life is not your own to take. You were bought with a price. But yet we continue to go out and do heroin, we continue to do meth, we continue to drink, we continue to use mind-altering substances, even though we know that it is killing our brains. In 1 Corinthians 6:19, it says, or do you not know, that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? Your body, your very body is the temple. You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your bodies. We need to take some of these things that we know, that we are even hearing right now today. We need to open up the minds of our spirits. We need to turn our cell phones off. We need to turn our brains on to the fullest extent that we possibly are physically able to do. And we need to hear the word of the Lord today that can save your life and change your life forever. Ephesians 4 says this, now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding. They are alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. Do you have a hard heart today? Do you think you know more than God knows? Like the song that was sung this morning, you don't know that person sitting next to you today, right here in this building, doesn't have an answer to change your life forever. Don't harden your heart. We need to open our hearts up to one another. It's just like the songster said, we need each other. We need each other. And then it goes on to say that they have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice of every kind of impurity. But this is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, to put off the old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and incorrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in the true righteousness and holiness. We're to put it off. Put off your old self. Put it off. Take it off like you take off a sweater or off a coat, and put on the newness that Christ wants you to have. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, he loves you so much. He wants you to save your life. He wants to be able to fulfill the destiny that he has for you. And then it goes on, it says, therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. We're just like that song. Audra, thank you for bringing that to my attention. We are members one to another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Listen, every time you step out from that shadow of the Almighty God, every time you step out from his covering, every time you walk away from his covering, you are giving the enemy, who is Satan, who is the devil, who is a real foe, opportunity to create havoc in your life, and opportunity to even steal your life and even take your own life. It says, be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. We need to be renewed in the spirit of our minds. What you thought was a reality may not be a reality at all. Maybe we need today to have a reality check. We need to check out, what are we thinking about? There's a constant war going on between good and evil. And the little commercial where the devil with the horns is sitting here and the angel is sitting here, that's true. There is a constant war going on between good and evil. And we need to recognize what it is because it's rampant today. And we need to stop allowing certain things to come into the database of our mind. And that includes physical things. Stop abusing your bodies. Stop abusing your brains. Stop abusing your mind with mind-altering substances. Stop listening to the wrong things. We need a new wake-up call today because we need to survive. We do not want to perish because of a lack of knowledge, because of a hardened heart. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a serious time. This is something we need to be aware of. And we need to not just be aware of it, but we need to receive it into the spirit of our minds, inside of us. So we don't just get up out of our seats today and go, well, yeah, that's all. That was pretty good. I was kind of bored today. But, you know, and when we walk outside, we're able to receive it and to know that the word of the Lord is true, that if we take him on and put on the new self, that he will be able to direct our step into the heights of glory that you can't even imagine.
Amen.
You know, I was looking up some names in the Bible because, you know, there's a constant battle between good and evil, and we need to move our life forward. We need to get out of the hood. We need to come out of the hood. So I was looking up some names of some gangs, and I want you to, I'm going to preface this, because the Bible says that we are to call those things that are not as though they were. That's what it says. Call those things that are not as though they were. So I'm looking up these names, and here's a good one. The Faceless Ones. That's a gang name. The Faceless Ones. Now listen, if you can call things that are not as though they were, it works the opposite too. The Faceless Ones, here's another good one. The Men of Limbo. Now, men, do you want to be in limbo? You don't want to be in limbo. Can you imagine being part of a gang that is called the Men of Limbo? We get mixed in with things that are a little shady. You know, sometimes the women like to hang out with a bad boy. You know, it's kind of fun, it's kind of exciting, you know. We wanna open up the newspaper in the morning or get on our cell phones. People don't even have newspapers anymore except for my husband. He still gets the newspaper. I don't know why, but he does. We wanna open our cell phone, we go right to the horoscope. We wanna know what our day is gonna look like. You know, there's some idiot sitting up somewhere making up all these horoscope stuff, and then we're gonna open it up and go, oh man, we're going to have a bad day today. I mean, why do we do that? We don't even know where that stuff comes from. But we want to walk with where the horoscope. We want to go to the fortune teller, have them read our palm, see what our life is going to look like. We'd rather do that than open up the Word of God and have the truth of the word, have him tell us the truth of what our life is going to look like. We get mixed up with weird stuff, and we get mixed up with witchy kinds of stuff, and we're drawn to that. We're drawn to witchy kinds of stuff. I know when I was younger, I went to a fortune teller. I wanted her to read my palm. You know, I was having a bad life. I was hoping anybody tell me something good, you know. And I went to the wrong place, though. Anytime you do those kinds of things, you're opening a door. You are opening a door.
Amen.
Every time you look at your horoscope, you're opening a door.
That's right.
You're opening a door for Satan to come in and create havoc in your life. The Word of God says, do not listen to those kinds of things. We seek anything we can other than the truth of God's Word. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. What are you thinking about in your heart? Your attitude and your belief system, those are going to direct your paths a little bit. We need to think about what are we looking at? What are we seeing? Are we sitting around watching pornography all day? Because I'll tell you right now, if you are, that is a wrong thing. You are opening a door for Satan. If that's what you're doing, you need to stop it right now. The weapons are of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. Listen, we all have strongholds in our life. We have generational things that come about and come upon us. You know, somebody's father kills himself and then the son thinks that that's okay to do. They're thinking, well, I just want to end my life. Well, let me give you a big warning and a good shock to your system this morning. You may want to end your life, but you don't understand that there is a place called heaven and there is a place called hell.
Right.
If you end your life, you better be careful. You better know for sure that you're going to go to heaven. Because if you go to hell, it's a place that is permanent, and you don't get to wake up in the morning and go, well, I'm sorry, please forgive me.
That's
it
right.
Doesn't work that way, ladies and gentlemen. It's time that we start smartening up. It's time that we talk about some of these things. It is time that we have a wake-up call, a reality check. Your life is not your own to take. Don't even think about it. Don't even think about that. We get so mixed up. We need to break the strongholds of the curse of the generations.
That's right.
We need to break some strongholds so that we can move our life forward and be present in the loving care of our Father. Our mind is at war, and Satan knows that if he gets our mind, then he can ruin and take our life. Why do you think that drugs are called mind-altering substances? Why? Why do you think that? Because Satan wants your mind. If he can get your mind, he has your life. It's a battle between good and evil, and that is reality. Read your Bible. Read your Bible. But when we receive Christ into our life, the old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. We need to have all things become new. I'm a bottom line person. I like to hear what the bottom line is. You know, I don't like all this theology stuff. I can't pay attention to theology, and there's a time and a place for that. I can't deal with all of that. I'm bottom line. Give me the bottom line. If I'm talking to somebody, I'm hoping there's a bottom line in there sometime. You know, sometimes people go on and on and on. I'm just saying, get to the bottom, get to the point. I just want to hear the point. You know, so if you're a bottom line person, you're probably going to be married to somebody that is not a bottom line person. What is the word I'm looking for? They are, hang on, let me find what I'm looking for because it's good. Oh, I can't find my note. I probably got ahead of myself. It's all right. You're probably married to a beat around the bush person. That's it. I'm bottom line. You're probably married to a beat around the bush because two beat around the bush people would never get married because they would never know when to get married. Beat around the bush. There's a world outside of our circumstances. There is a world outside of our circumstances. Have you ever driven through a neighborhood and the neighborhood's run down? The houses all need paint. There's, you know, broken down vehicles out in the front yard. There's an old worn couch at the side of the house. It's an old neighborhood that's beat up. It's filled full of kind of debris and trash. And you go to, you drive a little bit further and the next house is that way and the next house is that way. And pretty soon the whole area, the whole block just seems kind of dark and the atmosphere is different there, isn't it? In an old beat up neighborhood, it's the atmosphere there, it's different. And then you drive around the corner and around the corner is these lovely painted manicured yard houses and it uplifts you all of a sudden. You feel different in that neighborhood than you do in the old beat up neighborhood. And it's like our circumstances. We can be having a bad time. We might not know how we're going to get out of it, but I'm just telling you, don't let your circumstances drive your life. Just drive around the corner. That's all you got to do, because around the corner, there's a rainbow. Just drive around the corner. Ephesians 6:13 says this, "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm." Sometimes we're all hyped up and we go, yeah, I think I can do that. I get all motivated. Yeah, I can get out of this. I can move my life forward. And then we have another problem come and we don't know what to do. We've done everything we know. The Bible says, take up the whole armor. You take up the whole armor and you still don't get it. And the Bible said, don't worry. Don't worry. Quit worrying. All you got to do is just stand. Just stand. You might have a thought of suicide come when you have problems. I've had that before. I thought, oh, God, I just want to kill myself, you know? But just stand. The thought will go away. Don't take action. Your life is not your own to take. We need to be careful of our feelings. God gave us feelings for a reason, but we need to be careful. We need to be watchful. You know, I hear so many people say, oh, I'm just sad all the time. I'm depressed. I feel anxious. I have such high anxiety. I just can't stand it anymore. We need to be careful about our feelings and not let our feelings dictate our future. Ask and you shall receive, the Bible says. Ask. Ask God. Ask God to give you, put on a spirit of joy. Put on some, women are the worst. They get a set, they're all depressed, and they want to play sad music. So we go in our room, we play sad songs, and then we cry. And then, you know, we look at ourselves in the mirror, and we're crying. That makes us cry more. You men have done the same thing. That's not the way to get over it. The way to get over it is we got to play music that makes us want to dance.
Yeah.
You know? We got to picture Heidi up here when she's dancing like she does, you know? That's the way to, don't sulk around. Don't stay in that area of sulking around and poor me and having a pity party. I have some really big pity parties and then nobody comes. And that's the way it should be. Don't help somebody feel sorry for themselves. You know? Faith comes first and then we receive. God asked a group of men to form two lines. And one of the lines was for all of the men who were the head of their household. The other line was for the men who let their wives be the head of the household. And God came out and he saw there was probably 100 men in this one line. And all of that line was the ones who were not the head of the household. And there was one man standing in the other line. And God said, men, I'm so ashamed of you. You were not the head of your households, and we only have one man that was the head of his household. And he said, I'm so proud of you. How did you do it? What did you do? The man said, I don't know. My wife told me to stand here. We need to take some time to get to know him. Men, here's an announcement to make. You are the head of your household. That is God's order. Women, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I've lost you all, haven't I, women? I'm sorry, but that's God's order. God's order. Man is the head of his household. That's the way it is. That's it. And men, you have a huge responsibility. You have a heavy weight on your shoulders because it is your job to be the head of your household. You are to lead as Christ led the church. You are to love, if you're married, you're to love your wife the way that Christ loves the church. And men, here's a secret. If you will do that, Your wife will just follow right behind your footsteps. You won't have to have any big deals. You won't have to have any big arguments. You won't have to have any big disagreements. Why? Because you've learned about the Word of God, and you know how Christ loved His church, and you know that Christ gave His life for His church, and you will just lead her, and she will be so happy. She will be happy. And then your children will watch this, and then your children will come along, and then your children will learn how to do this, and then they will be happy. And don't tell me it doesn't work, because I personally know that it does. If we would just learn there is order. Everybody wants to be the boss, but nobody wants to work hard enough to be one. Everybody wants to be important, but they don't want to work hard enough to be important. In Isaiah 42, it says, I will lead them in paths that they know not of. I will make darkness light before them. We need to renew our minds, and we need to get a new desire in our heart. And we need to know how to effectuate these things. And there's a scripture in the Bible that says, God, I thank you that you are effectually at work within me, creating and energizing in me both the power and the desire to will and to work for your good pleasure, satisfaction, and delight. And I will tell you right now that every man, woman, and child in this room ought to memorize that scripture. And you ought to say it every day, over and over and over and over and over. And all we need to do today is we just need to take the first step. We just need to try. We need to remember that each one of us is linked together. What happens to one affects the others, and we have learned this last couple of weeks around here. But I tell you what, we need to know how important your part is. If you don't do your part, I can't do my part. And that's how we are linked together. Now, come on. Let's renew our minds. Let none of us perish because of lack of knowledge. You have been given a bit of knowledge from God's Word today. And I pray and ask that you take that word, you take that little tidbit of wisdom, and when you walk out this door, you do not forget it. And you don't think all of a sudden that there is no lot meaning to life, because that's not true. Don't let Satan lie to you, because he's the father of lies. Remember each other's faces today. Remember who's sitting next to you today. Put on the new life today. Who has a prayer request? Sean.
Two prayers, Mary. One, I'd just like to pray for Heather and I, just for courage and strength, guidance, wisdom, moving forward, just on the new things that we're doing in life right now. And the second thing I would like to pray for is this organization and the anointing that's on your life and the covering that happens when people are close to this organization and when they step out from that, you know. And I just want to pray to just continue to build you up and just keep that covering over this organization, because it's real.
Thank you, Sean. Yes.
For our housemate, Joel, who's having surgery this week on his back. So.
Joel.
I want to be like this organization and be debt-free and have a credit score of 850.
I second that.
Speak things that are not as though they were.
It's funny, but it's also like we make prayer requests, or I make prayer requests that are typically heartfelt, sentimental, and I felt shallow and selfish in asking for something like that. Like, I'd like to have a bank account that has money in it.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
A savings account. Yeah. You know, things like that, that it's like, it's not, at least what I'm learning from you, it's not. So it's not the Word of God.
It is the Word of God, yes. I pray that God give you supernatural finances, and I pray that He give you a credit score of 850. And I pray that He heal you quickly. I know you have surgery coming up, and I just pray that it's not as bad as what the initial report was, that God is your healer. He will lead and guide the surgeon's hand, and you will recover quick.
Thank you.
Thank you. Who else? Yes, Sylvia.
We also have a housemate who's having surgery.